Hello, everyone, and thank you for joining us for our talk on generative AI and product design. My name is James, and I'm a design lead with Thoughtworks in Singapore.
Hi, I'm Esther. I'm a research lead with Thoughtworks, also in Singapore. At Thoughtworks, we've been exploring generative AI for research and design, and our talk today has two parts, which complement each other and look at the potential of AI in our day-to-day work. Let's begin part one and explore how GenAI is reshaping product design workflows. A full disclosure, ChatGPT helped to write the title for this section. Some humor for starters. In French, phonetically, ChatGPT sounds like cat, I farted. On the right is an image I tried to generate with the prompt, cat, I farted. Well, the AI couldn't understand the phrase, so I had to change my prompt a few times, finally settling on owner farting at cat to get my meaning across. As you can see, Gen AI still has quite a long way to go. The artificial intelligence hype isn't new. It was first coined in 1956 at a historic conference at Dartmouth. Since then, there have been a few waves of heightened interest. At the beginning, we've been using AI systems primarily to analyze data and make predictions. And these systems were expensive. Think IBM's Deep Blue, famous for beating chess grandmaster Garry Kasparov. The next wave around the 2000s saw machine learning being used in robotics to make them more autonomous, improve their functionality, and make them more intuitive for humans to use. Home robots like the Roomba were first introduced in 2002. This is also the time we see the rise of big data, where storage was getting cheaper and data was becoming abundant as there was a push to digitize everything, paving the way for the deep learning wave we are experiencing today. So now we're in the third wave. 2011 to 2014 saw the launch of Apple's Siri, Google's Google Now, and Microsoft's Cortana, digital assistants on your smartphone that use natural language to answer questions, make recommendations, and perform actions. Most recently, data is being used to train generative AI models in order for it to generate new content that's similar to a set of training data. We see this in a whole variety of apps, the most popular of which is ChatGPT. So who is behind Gen AI? These are all commercial brands. Their objective is revenue, and that is what's driving the research and innovation in this space today. Nothing much is happening in academia or government, hence it is why there is a cause for concern. Google's chief AI scientist resigned so he could openly talk about the dangers of AI. There is currently an open letter from AI scientists and leaders in these very space companies calling on governments to regulate the space and to introduce a pause and slow down the rapid rate of development. The European Union and the United States have since responded with regulations for AI. So why has there been such a huge uptake with ChatGPT? It's mainly because of how accessible Gen AI has become. And it all begins with a prompt. The success of the output depends upon the quality of the input. This is why prompt engineering is now becoming a thing. And reassuringly for design and product people, if you are good at what you do, then you'll probably be very good at prompts. Gen AI tools in the hands of non-practitioners can deliver patchy results, but if you really understand your craft, then Gen AI can produce some efficiencies plus things that you couldn't previously do. Boris Elgdesen won the Sony World Photography Awards with this AI-generated piece. He later declined the award, but the point here is AI in the hands of trained practitioners and craftsmen can produce some amazing work. Artists who have successfully embraced GenAI tools are using them to augment their creativity, not as a substitute for creativity. You are no doubt wondering, how might GenAI help designers? There has been a recent explosion of AI tools, apps, and plugins in the design and product space. Keep in mind, a lot of them may still be in beta and are not that great yet. If we take a look at the end-to-end design process, such as the double diamond here, you can probably find some sort of AI tool for everything. AI can assist in generating new ideas, analyze large amounts of data, identify patterns, provide inspiration, automate time-consuming tasks like resizing images, allowing designers to focus on higher-level creative decisions. It can facilitate rapid prototyping, creating wireframes and screens based on your inputs, and even write UX copy that reads more naturally than Lorem Ipsum. This is just a sample list of 100 tools that are possible for designers to use across the whole design lifecycle process. AI is revolutionizing the way that designers can work, from automating repetitive tasks to generating unique ideas. And with the help of these tools, we can work more efficiently, create better designs, and streamline our workflow. AI can be used to support research efforts from desk research to discovery, but we should be cautious not to blindly trust them. It is a fact that ChatGPT and Bard tell us things that we know are factually incorrect. However, it can save us time when trying to collect vast amounts of information. With a few prompts and questions, AI can then give us information that we can read through and double-check with more trusted sources. There are many tools to assist us in designing. Image generation tools like DALL-E and Midjourney can enable designers to create unique and high-quality visuals based on specific styles and concepts. With these descriptive prompts, the more precise you write them, the better the outcomes generated. Sketch to React and Adobe Sensei offer tools to optimize your design layouts. These AI algorithms can automatically arrange elements on a page, optimize white space, and suggest design improvements. Palette platforms like Adobe Colors and Color Cooler use AI to generate harmonious color combinations, which can save designers a lot of time and enhance visual coherence in our work. Then we have no-code tools such as Visual Copilot, which can convert Figma designs into React, Angular, or HTML code in real time with one click on the Figma plugin. This can allow you to create a proof of concept super quickly without even having to write a line of code. And then there are tools that we can use for copywriting. Have you run into a situation where your client asks you to explain what the lorem ipsum in your prototype means? AI can help to create placeholder text that is more tailored and contextual rather than Latin words on the screen. Let's look at the different ways we can integrate these kinds of tools with the design process. For exploring user scenarios, there's a Figma plugin called Quoquo. This tool can generate user interview discussion guides for collecting insights, generate personas, user journey maps, UX copywriting, and design checklists. In this example, I'm using Quoquo to build a persona. Let's say a 30-year-old designer living in Singapore is looking for a good doctor. While Quoquo can quickly generate a set of user goals, needs, motivations, frustrations, and tasks, it is unclear where this data comes from and might be too generic for the context of your problem space. Still, it can be useful as a starting point to generate discussions to refine your user persona so it is more realistic and inclusive. For building wireframes, there is a Figma plugin called Wireframe Designer. It turns text input into editable wireframes. This can be great for discovery inception, where you just want to put these ideas down. In this example, I'll give Wireframe Designer a prompt to generate a wireframe. For the first pass, I gave it a generic input, doctor appointment app. The generated result is a lot of widgets and modules randomly stacked. You have your upcoming appointments, reviews of random doctors, etc. And the information is overwhelming, and I'm not sure what I'm supposed to do on the screen. For the second pass, I refined the inputs to tell Wireframe Designer I'd like it to create a general practitioner appointment app to be able to show doctors by clinic, show design distance of clinic to my location, and doctor reviews. The result is a wireframe that looks more like some thought has been put into the design, and users who come here now can know that they can search for a doctor to book an appointment. For prototyping, apps like User can help across the design process in creating many UX artifacts, including clickable prototypes and more. You can tell exactly what you want designed and give it a description of the style you want. In this example, I want User to make an app to create recipes from leftover ingredients in my fridge. It then presumably generates a user flow, or rather a sequence of screens in the style that I've prescribed. As you can see, the generated designs are going to be basic. It is not using any new design patterns and definitely reliant on what's been trained on. Some screens also don't make complete sense. I'm not sure what the home dashboard is trying to convey because I wanted an app to create recipes based on the constraints of limited items in my fridge, not create a shopping list. User is not going to come up with anything groundbreaking or innovative, but it gives you a basic foundation that you can springboard off of. For proof of concept, Imagica can create working proof of concept apps using SAS. This example is going to be a recipe generator app that allows users to generate a recipe based on their input using real-time data. You start off with a user input node to capture the ingredients input for the recipe generator. Then I want the AI to create a recipe based on the user's input. You can also connect with and plug in to integrations. For example, here I'm selecting an image generator. So there will be a food image to go along with the recipe that you generate. And on the right, there's a preview to show you how your app looks. So once you have configured how you want the preview to look, you can tell Imagica to generate the user interface and publish as SAS. And now you have quickly spun up a recipe generator proof of concept. So let's quickly take a look at it in action. On a serious note, let's briefly consider the ethics of using AI. Will AI help us design better experiences for people? Or in deploying AI into our products and services, would it have unintended consequences for them? There's been a lot of noise over how these AI models are being trained and what's being used to train them. There are claims of artistic styles being stolen and copyrighted material being used for training purposes. AI is only as good as the data it's fed. And AI has made the headlines for biased recruiting, sending the wrong people to jail, and giving harmful advice to vulnerable people. The Ethical Data Project, NCATCH, just released a study that examines consumer sentiment around AI and the personal data that powers it. While privacy, agency, and transparency talks about consumers wanting to know what data is collected, why it is collected, and how it is stored and used, fairness and accountability involves how companies use AI, such as to inform and predict consumer behavior or aid product design decisions. Consumers are aware that AI is biased, and they want assurance that we are going to build products responsibly. We have accepted that AI can and does make good assistance. The concern arises when we allow AI to take over and make decisions for us. Decision-making needs to be owned by humans. Now, this is a real photograph, not AI-generated, of a restaurant kitchen. This is called the pass, the most crucial point where the head chef calls out orders to the line cooks and inspects every single plated dish before it is sent out the kitchen. Even if AI becomes our line cooks, we cannot replace the head chef with AI. Humans still need to own the decision-making process because we know what good looks like, not AI. And we all know that our clients can't always articulate what they want, so they can't exactly go into these tools and say, AI, make me my app. They are still going to need us to support them to help them build the right products. We should stay informed of how these tools, practices, and technologies work so we can embrace them instead of being threatened by them. In part two, James will look at what generative AI might mean for our workflows and ask how much of our research and design process should we want to automate.